In this lecture, I am going to discuss some of the applications of Gauss's theorem. So there are some applications by using Gauss's theorem. Let us discuss one. Okay. So first one is electric field due to an infinitely long straight wire carrying some charges. This is the first application of Gauss's theorem. For that, let us consider a long straight wire, because in the problem it is a long straight wire. So consider a long straight wire. This is a long straight wire having some charges. Okay. So that I am considering some charges in it. This is positive. It is made up of positive charges. Let us assume it is a long straight wire and it is infinitely long, means its length is not fixed to this much of space only. It is having more length in this direction and in this direction. We are just marking some of the length only, but please remember that it is an infinitely long straight wire, so that it is extending in this direction as well as in this direction. Okay, now since it carries charge, it will produce an electric field at some point. Let us try to calculate the electric field due to this long straight wire at a point P. This is our intention. We want to find the electric field at P due to this infinitely long straight wire, which is made up of positive charges. Okay. Now, it is actually a continuous charge distribution, because you can see that it is not only one or two charges. Since it is infinitely long, there will be infinite number of charges in this wire, isn't it? So it is actually having large number of charges. When there are large number of charges which are distributed continuously, you can call it as continuous charge distribution. So while discussing continuous charge distribution, I explained three terms: linear charge density, surface charge density, and volume charge density. In this case, it is a wire which is having very small thickness, which means you can consider almost it is one dimensional. Thickness is very small, so this dimension along this direction, the dimension is very very small, so you can neglect that dimension along this direction. Direction and dimension are different things. Please remember, along this direction, the dimension of the wire is very small, so you can neglect this dimension along this direction. Okay, but in this direction there is some finite dimension, it is having some length, so only dimension is in this direction, so it is a one dimensional wire. When it is a one dimensional case, a very narrow wire, you can define a charge density that is linear charge density, isn't it? So let us define that there is a linear charge density of lambda. Linear charge density means the amount of charges present in unit length. That is the definition for linear charge density. So lambda is the linear charge density, which is nothing but charges per unit length. Okay, so let us imagine that total Q charges are there. In the total length, Q charges are there in L length. Okay, it is an infinitely long straight wire, so we will consider an L length. In that L length, let us say that there are q charges. Okay, that L length is sufficient enough. Only charges present in that L length will produce some electric field at P. A charge which is very very far away will not make any influence at P. So we will assume that a length of L, this wire is having a length L. We will assume some length which is L, which in which charges will make some field at P. Those charges which are beyond L length, we don't need to consider because they are far away, so that they will not make any field at P. Okay. So now, in L length, there are Q charges in L length. In L length, there are Q charges. Total L length, if you consider, there are Q charges. Okay. Then in unit length, in L length you are having Q charges, then in unit length you will have Q by L charges. So the number of charges present in unit length is called lambda. Okay, we previously discussed that lambda is equal to dQ by dL, in which we considered that in a small element dL, dQ charges are there. So we defined lambda as dQ by dL. If charges are distributed, then instead of small length dL, you can consider the entire length L. In that entire length L, if Q charges are there, which are distributed uniformly, then instead of dL and dQ, you can consider Q and L. So lambda can be changed into Q by L if it is uniform distribution. Okay, so we are assuming a uniform distribution in which there are Q by L charges present per unit length. So lambda is Q by L according to this one. Okay, now I am again considering the wire here. You are having the wire like this, and in that wire you are having charges. These are continuous charges, which means there won't be any gap. Positive charges will be continuously distributed. I am marking only 5-6 charges, but it is continuously distributed. There will be large number of charges. Okay, and you are going to find the electric field at a point P. So in order to apply Gauss's theorem, let us first write Gauss's theorem. According to Gauss's theorem, integral E dot ds, this is dot product, is equal to Q enclosed by epsilon 0. This is the statement of Gauss's theorem. But here it is a closed surface integral, isn't it? You need a closed surface, then only you can apply this closed surface integral. But here you are having an open surface. You don't have any surface. You are having only a wire. For applying Gauss's theorem, you need a closed surface. So if the closed surface is not available, you need to construct a closed surface. Then only you can apply Gauss's theorem. This is very very important. So you need to construct a closed surface, then only you can apply Gauss's theorem. Okay, how you will construct a closed surface, that depends upon the problem. Any closed surface you can consider, but always remember that decide those surface which will make the problem easy to solve. Any shape you can consider, but always try to get a shape which can easily solve the problem. Okay, so like that we will decide which shape we will use, and the surface which we will use to solve such problems are called a Gaussian surface. So Gaussian, G-A-U-S-S-I-A-N. Gaussian surface means any problem in electrostatics, if we want to apply Gauss's theorem, we need to consider a closed surface. That problem must be in a closed surface. Charges must be enclosed in a closed surface. So we need to consider a closed surface. Such closed surfaces used in Gauss's theorem are called a Gaussian surface. It can be spherical, it can be cylindrical, it can be cubical, depends upon the problem. Which shape will make the problem simplified, you will use that shape. Okay, so in this case, the most easiest shape which can solve the problem very easily within some steps is a sphere. I will tell you why. This is a line charge, a straight wire. If you consider a sphere like this, then you can see that in the case of sphere, you can use such a shape, but the problem is that then your solution will become more complicated, because you can see that if you consider a sphere like this, there will be problems like how to find this left side, integral e dot ds, area vector and other things will become more complicated, because some charges are here, some are here, then how to consider the area vector, all those things will make the problem complicated. If you consider a cube, then from your wire to this point, there will be different distance from here to here, here to here, here to here, etc., which will again make the problem more complicated. So the best shape which can easily solve this problem is a cylinder. So that I will consider a cylinder. Okay, so cylinder is my Gaussian surface in this case. You can easily understand it from this. If I consider a cylinder which includes P also, okay, my cylinder includes P also. This is my cylinder. Now you can understand why I selected a cylinder. If you consider the case, you can see all my charges are now enclosed in the cylinder. Okay, all my charges are enclosed in the cylinder. Another thing, cylinder is having a fixed radius that you can define. Okay, now from this positive charge to this, whatever be the distance, same distance is there from here to here, from here to here. So this P can be anywhere in this line. Whatever be the position of P, your electric field equation will be same, because all these charges are at same distance from this line. So whether this charge or this charge you are using, it does not make any problem, isn't it? Because your P will be shifted only. It can be here, it can be here, but your equation will be same, isn't it? So this is the reason why we selected a cylinder as a Gaussian surface. Now it is easy. Next thing is, you need to apply this equation. In order to apply this equation, it must be a surface integral, a closed surface integral. Now you got a closed surface which is a cylinder, so your Gaussian surface is cylindrical. But the next thing is that you need to consider how many surfaces are there. If one surface is there, you need to apply surface integral on that surface. If two surfaces are there, you need to apply surface integral on those two surfaces. Like that, how many surfaces are there, you need to apply Gauss's theorem on all those surfaces. Here, if you consider one surface is here, this upper surface, another surface is here, downward surface, and you can see a curved surface also. This is a curved surface. This from here to here, you are having a curved surface like this, isn't it? It is a curved surface from starting from here to here. Then there is a top surface and there is a bottom surface. So there are three surfaces, isn't it? You are having three surfaces, which means you will have three such equations. So let us consider integral E dot ds is equal to what are the three surfaces? Surface S1, E dot ds, isn't it? Plus, where S1 is nothing but this surface, okay, plus closed integral E dot ds, E dot ds for surface S2, where S2 is this surface, plus closed integral E dot ds for this curved surface. This is S3, surface 3. So you are having three surface integrals. Left side, you need to evaluate three surface integral. Now let us see one by one. What is closed integral E dot ds over S1? If you check this S1, this is S1. If you draw an area vector on S1, how it will be? Area vector must be perpendicular to the surface. So the area vector must be like this, which will make 90 degree with your surface. This is your area vector. So I am just denoting it as S. Okay, S means area vector, S vector. Okay, now what will be your E dot ds? Here another thing is that this is your positive charge. Electric field is radial, which means from a charge, electric field will move away from that charge or towards the charge. From positive charge, always electric field will move away. So the electric field associated with this one, this positive charge, will be in this direction only and in this direction only. It will not be in the upward direction like this or like this. Okay, it is radial because your wire is like this, your wire is like this. So the electric field produced by wire is either in this direction or in this direction. It cannot be like this and this. Okay, so each charge will produce electric field either on this direction or this direction, which we will call it as radial. Electric field is radial. Okay, so the electric field is radial, which means electric field will be always in that direction, radial direction only. Okay, so I am marking the electric field direction here. If you consider, you can see that electric field will be, let us take another color, electric field will be in this direction E. Now if you check, electric field is in this direction, whereas area vector is in this direction. What is the angle between electric field and area vector? Area vector we can use ds, okay, not s, we can use ds. Now what is the electric field angle between electric field and ds vector? It is 90 degree. So this will be closed integral E dot ds means E ds cos theta. What is the theta here? 90. So this one will be 0 because cos 90 is 0. Okay, so the first integral term is 0, this one is 0. Okay, similarly if you check the second integral S2 E dot ds, you can see that this is the surface S2. Okay, for that surface, if you draw the surface vector, that is area vector, it will be a little bit like this. Let us consider on the charge itself, surface, it will be like this, which is making 90 degree with the surface. Okay, so with the same reason, electric field will be like this. This is the electric field, whereas surface vector is like this, which means they are making an angle 90 degree. This is 90 degree. Again you will get EDS cos 90, so that it is again 0. Okay, so second integration is also 0. Reason is that angle is 90 degree between electric field and area vector. Okay, now if you consider the third surface is nothing but this curved surface. In the curved surface, you can see that at any point, if you consider that your point P is here, if you consider that point, there will be an area vector like this. which is nothing but a vector. You see, it is making 90 degree. If your point P is not there, but if it is here, again you can see that if your point is, that is again making 90 degree with your point surface, Gaussian surface. So it is a normal. Okay, but what is the angle between electric field and that vector? Your electric field will be like this. From any point, electric field is like this. Means electric field direction is like this, isn't it? If you consider the point here, electric field is again like this. So you can see that area vector and electric field vector will be parallel to each other, isn't it? This diagram here, you can see area vector is in this direction, electric field is also in the same direction. So the angle will be 0 degree between area vector and electric field, isn't it? So that you can write the third integral. You are having the third integral S3, closed integral S3 E dot ds. You are going to evaluate that. So your total integral E dot ds will become 0, first term is 0, second term is 0, third term is S3 E dot ds. Now we need to calculate only the third term, that is S3 E dot ds. Okay, so what is it? Closed integral S3 E dot ds. So what is E dot ds? E ds cos theta. What is the theta here? They are parallel, E and ds. If you check this diagram, you can see that E and ds are parallel to each other. So theta is 0 degree. Hence your theta will be 0 degree. Cos 0. What is cos 0? It is 1. So it is equal to closed integral S3 E ds, because cos 0 is 1. Okay, so you got closed integral E ds as the third integral. Now let us consider this case. It is actually charges are uniform, so that it is making a uniform electric field. Your charges are distributed uniformly. Initially itself I said that charges are distributed uniformly, so that uniform charges, when charges are distributed uniformly, they are making a uniform field. Okay, so that E is uniform. Uniform means same everywhere. E will not change, it is a constant. So you can take E out of the integration, then only ds will remain. Okay, what is ds here? If you consider, you considered only for this curved surface. Okay, curved surface you considered E dot ds, and in that E is constant, so you can take it out. Now ds, what is ds for this curved surface? It is nothing but surface area of this curved surface, isn't it? Integral, closed integral ds means surface area of this closed surface, that is, sorry, curved surface, isn't it? So you know what is the surface area of this curved surface in the case of a cylinder. The cylinder is having a length L. I already told that this length is L. Your Gaussian surface is having, if you consider it as height, you can consider that it is having a height of L, and this point is at a distance of R. Okay, so height is L, and from the center of the cylinder your point P is at a distance of R. So what is the surface area of such a cylinder? You already know, if this is your cylinder with length L and from center to here R, then the surface area of your curved side is 2 pi r L, isn't it? So that
your E into, here you are having E into closed integral ds. That closed integral ds is nothing but 2 pi RL. Okay, so that you can rewrite it as equal to E into 2 pi RL. So finally you are getting closed integral E dot ds. This is what you evaluated for the total Gaussian surface is equal to 3 terms, but 2 terms are 0, so that you are getting finally due to 1 term, and its answer is E into 2 pi RL, isn't it? Now according to Gauss's theorem, what is the statement of Gauss's theorem? Closed integral E dot ds is equal to Q enclosed by epsilon 0. This is the statement of Gauss's theorem, isn't it? And we already found this side, closed integral E dot ds, we found it and we got the answer as E into 2 pi RL. So left side we got, what is the term on left side? We got it as E into 2 pi RL from equation 1. If you consider it as equation 1, from equation 1 you got left side as E into 2 pi RL. That must be equal to Q enclosed by epsilon 0 according to Gauss's theorem. Okay, now what is Q enclosed? If you find Q enclosed and substitute, you will get the answer. So what is Q enclosed? Here you can see we defined lambda as Q by L. Okay, so normally it is dq by dl, but if it is uniform distribution, I told you that you can take it as q by l instead of dq by dl. Okay, now if you check this diagram, total charge enclosed in your Gaussian surface is nothing but q by l, because your Gaussian surface is having l length. In l length there are q charges, so in this total length there are q charges. Then in unit length, in l length of this Gaussian surface, that is cylindrical surface, you are having Q charge. Okay, so in your L length you are having Q charge, L length you are having Q charge. So in unit length you will have Q by L charge. Amount of charge in unit length is nothing but charge, linear charge density. So you will get, if you want you can use Q enclosed, but we can use simply as Q. Okay, so in L length you are having Q amount of charge. It is not a single charge, total charge I am taking it as Q, enclosed charge. In your L length enclosed charge is Q. So in unit length it will be Q by L. Charges present in unit length is called a linear charge density. So lambda is equal to Q by L, from which you can write Q is equal to lambda L. If you take this L on the other side, then you will get Q is equal to lambda L. So Q enclosed, this Q is nothing but enclosed charge by the Gaussian surface. Q enclosed is equal to lambda L. So that you can substitute this Q enclosed for this Q enclosed. Okay, then what you will get? You will get it as, on one side you are having E into 2 pi RL. E into 2 pi RL is equal to, on other side you are having Q enclosed. What is Q enclosed? That is equal to lambda L by epsilon 0 is there. So that you can write epsilon 0. Now your intention is to find electric field only. That is lambda L divided by, if you take 2 pi RL on this side, then there is an epsilon 0. Now you can see that L and L get cancels. So finally what you will get? Lambda by 2 pi r epsilon 0. This is the equation for E. Okay, and this is the magnitude of E. What is the direction of E? Because E is a vector, so that you can find the direction of E. From this itself you can see that E is always moving outward. This point radially moving outward. Okay, so direction of E is radially outward from the straight wire. This is your straight wire. Direction of E is radially outward. You can see it is radially outward here as well as here. it is radially outward. Radially means it is from here, it is moving like this. This is called radial direction. Okay, so it is moving radially outward. In both the sides, it is radially outward. It is moving outward. Okay, so direction is radially outward, and magnitude is E is equal to lambda by 2 pi r epsilon 0, where lambda is the linear charge density and r is the radius of the Gaussian surface you considered. Here it is cylinder. Why we preferred cylinder? Because it is easy to find electric field if you use a cylinder as Gaussian surface. Okay, and what is the need of such a Gaussian surface? As I explained already, whenever you are applying Gauss's theorem, you need a closed surface. In this problem, you are having a straight wire, infinite length straight wire. It is not a closed surface. So in order to enclose this surface, you need a closed surface. So best choice is cylinder. So such choices you are using to solve a problem using Gauss's theorem is called as Gaussian surface. Here the Gaussian surface is a cylinder. Okay, in another derivation, the surface, Gaussian surface, will change to sphere or some other cases. Okay, so this is the first application. In this application, we got electric field due to an infinitely long straight wire. This is the infinitely long straight wire which is positively charged, and lambda is the amount of charge per unit length on that wire, which is uniform charge distribution. Okay, charges are distributed uniformly. So by doing some derivation, you got the field at a point P. P can be anywhere in this line or anywhere in this line. So at a point P, you got the equation for electric field as lambda divided by 2 pi epsilon 0 r by using Gauss's theorem. The same problem, if you apply Coulomb's theorem, you cannot solve within this many steps. This much of steps you can't solve. You need so many steps if you apply Coulomb's law. So that is the importance of Gauss's theorem. You can easily find out electric field in certain situations by applying Gauss's theorem as compared with Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law, if you apply, you will again get electric field. By finding electric force and dividing with the charge and all, you can get electric field, but it is a tedious job. You need so many steps. So that by applying Gauss's theorem, problem will be simplified, and you must select a Gaussian surface which will make the problem easy to solve. So this is the first application. Now some 2-3 more applications are there, which I will discuss in the coming lectures. So please go through this.